And with that, it's time for the first session of the evening, and it's going to be by Mr. Vijay J. Mansukhani, who is the co-producer of Merck Electronics and is also its managing director. He has been associated with Merck since its inception in 1981 as the key member in devising and implementing corporate growth strategy for Merck. He is also involved in the telecom sector. He is the managing director of Adeno Telecom Limited, a joint venture with NK Telecommunications India Limited. Mr. Mansukhani is also on the board of several companies. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would request Mr. Vijay Mansukhani, Managing Director, ONIDA, to kindly please come and join me on the stage, and he will be giving a special address on reinventing an iconic brand, the ONIDA story. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
First of all, let me thank Exchange for Media for inviting me to speak at this Pitch CMO conference. But let me tell you, I'm not a marketing guy. Each of you can teach me a lot about marketing. I'm an entrepreneur. And I started with nothing. So I had learned it the hard way. So along the way, I learned about marketing, finance, and everything, like from production to purchase to everything. But let me tell you very briefly about my life, which will be relevant to you. And why I'm saying relevant to you, what I really realized in my life is to recognize opportunities. I was from a very middle-class family. I was no big shot. My father expired when I was young, and my mother was just a housewife. So whatever I did, it's my first generation business here. I started my life as a marine engineer on the Shipping Corporation of India. And there I was. That was my first job at the age of 20. When I went to Australia, I found that the Australian guys are earning three times my salary. So I said, no, why should they earn three times when I should earn one? I left Shipping Corporation and joined Australia. Because I was fully qualified and I was what you call passed all my exams, they wouldn't make me the boss of the company, of the ships there, because they said, you're much too young. I said, okay, if I'm much too young and I'm not white enough, so I said, I left, I went to Iran. The Shah of Iran was there, and the Shah of Iran was paying double what Australia was paying. So here I was, I recognized the opportunities, and I'm saying this only because of recognizing opportunities. And I joined Iran, and I was earning six times of my colleagues. And I told my colleagues, what the hell are you working for one, and I'm working for six? Anyway, that was their problem. I came down to India. I used to get leave from the ships. And when I came down, I met a partner of mine, Mr. Meechandani, and he had a license for making televisions and video cassette recorders. And I recognized that as an opportunity. I said, oh my God, India doesn't have color TVs. We used to watch black and white TVs. So I recognized that as an opportunity, and so we tied up my money, his license, and we said, here we go. And to make things better, Indira Gandhi announced the Asian Games in Delhi. So she opened the gates to importing televisions. So here we were, here I was. I said, that's my end of my shipping career. At the age of 28, I was in Hong Kong buying TVs from all the places, wherever I could, and I was making a 40% margin. And of course, I love to meet people, socialize, and network and everything. And you know how it is with Sindhis in Hong Kong. There are a whole lot of Sindhis out there. They do a lot of financing. So one of those guys very condescendingly asked me in Sindhi, what do you do for your financing? And I said, I have none. So he said, would you like me to do financing? I said, yeah, sure, I'll do confirming for you. I said, I didn't know the name. I didn't know what confirming was. I knew, but it was something good. It was actually open letter of credit. So he gave me open letter of credit of $200,000. Now, $200,000 in those days was a lot of money. And I was turning them around twice in a month and making a 40% margin. Now, wow, now that was something. Until I went again, and I met a Chinese guy, and he said, I've never seen a bigger idiot than you. I said, yeah, what happened here? So he said, you're paying 4%. You know what you're doing, 4%, but I was making 50% if I paid 4%, big deal. And I was turning it around twice. So I was making 100%, out of which I was giving him 8%. But he's saying, you're giving him 96% in a year. I said, yeah, what will you do? I'll give you 2%. So I recognized this opportunity. I said, you know about something? He gives me $1 million. He said, what? I said, just look at my face. Honest guy. He said, you got it. $1 million, 2%. Wow. I was turning $1 million twice over in a month. You know, making 40%, paying 2% commission. That was it. So now, suddenly, Asian Games got over, the gates got shut. Indira Gandhi said, sorry, no more imports. So I said, oh my God, now what? Now we have to manufacture. So on my way to Hong Kong once, I was just waiting, and there was a Japanese guy sitting there, and we got talking, and I saw his boarding pass. It was blue color. I looked at my boarding pass. It was green color. He was in business class. I was in economy. And I asked him, what do you do? So he said, I'm with JVC. I said, oh, wow. Now that's the girl you want to marry, you know, a company. So I went to the Swiss Air person, then I said, hey, guys, I want to change my ticket. He said, what? You passed immigration. You're going to be boarding the plane now. So I said, no, but I want to upgrade to business class. He said, how are you going to do that? I said, I'll pay by credit card the same way I bought the ticket. She scratched her head. She says, she asked the Swiss Air girl, can we take this guy into business class? So she asked me, how will you pay? I said, by credit card. She said, yeah. So there I was. I sat next to the Japanese guy. And of course, this girl took my credit card. She swiped it, and she swiped it, and she swiped it, and she couldn't get anything because in those days, credit cards were valid only in India and Nepal, you know. I'm talking about 40 years back, you know. So here I got a free upgrade. I sat next to the Japanese guy and said, what are you doing in India? He says, man, I can't understand. Suddenly the floodgates have opened up. The whole world is coming to India, you know, because of the Asian Games. There are plane loads of TVs were coming, you know. And that opportunity I did not miss, you know. I did not miss that opportunity. Now I sat next to this guy. So I said, what's the plan? He said, I'm coming in 10 days' time with all the team. I've done the reconnaissance, and I'm bringing all the bosses here. So I said, do you mind? I mean, he said, yeah, of course, and all that. And I was quite surprised. I said, you're coming, and I'm not even on the list. Thank God I sat next to him. Thank God I met him, and thank God I talked to him. Although I would never have known that the JVC guys were coming. We went to the airport after 10 days. Every Tom, Dick, and Harry was there with flowers in their hand. I said, what the hell are you guys doing here? JVC. And there was Crown, Western, Dianora, Salora. You must be knowing all the older people, not the young girls here, but everybody would know. I didn't even have flowers in my hand, you know. But my friend had a Mercedes-Benz car. I requested her, I said, please, only this once. I want to borrow your car. So he said, yeah, sure them. So the Mercedes-Benz came to the airport. And of course, India had only Ambassadors and Fiats. I mean, none of you all, I mean, y'all are I'm much too old for you. But in those days, there was only two cars, Fiats and Ambassadors. The Japanese guys came, of course, all the Indians looked the same to them, you know. So but they recognized the car, you know. And they sat in that car, the Muslim. They got damn upset, all the other guys, you know. They said, hey, listen, man, we're going to the Taj. Taj. Everybody ran to the Taj. We took them home. By the end of the evening, ONIDA was born here. So that is a story of how ONIDA was born. And then, of course, JVC was, of course, one of the best companies in Japan. And we asked them that, let's do something new. I have to recognize the opportunity of one channel. The whole world used to watch on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock Ramayan. You know, the whole India used to come to a stop. Whole India used to come to a stop because from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock was Ramayan. And, of course, one channel, 3 hours in the morning, 3 hours in the evening. After that, nothing, you know. So, since we had a license to make VCRs and TVs, we started importing VCRs and started getting 9 system TVs, you know. 9 system, because nowadays you won't understand what 9 system. Because India uses only PAL, PAL, but Europe uses CCAM and America uses NTSC. All our televisions are PAL, CCAM, NTSC, and everybody used to get cassettes from abroad because they had no content, you know, so they used to watch the content on VCRs. And my God, we took off, you know. We were the only company selling 9 system TVs, so irrespective whether the cassette came from America or from New York, I mean from Europe, you could watch it on our TVs. Those were the heady days, great days. We were making money fist over heel and laughing all the way to the bank, you know. And then suddenly when it got shut, we had to start manufacturing. So we started manufacturing with JVC, and JVC was doing a damn good job. Now everybody started manufacturing. So we said, now we got to do some advertising. We went to all the advertising agencies and they said, what's your budget? I said, oh, what's the meaning of a budget? You know, I really didn't know what. I mean, how much budget to put and all that. I said, I just want to advertise. Said, come on, go to hell, yeah. You can't go just advertise. Anyway, we met these three guys who were starting, and they showed us this mascot of the devil, and they had this word, neighbors, envy, owners, pride, because we told them that our TVs are undoubtedly the best, you know. So it was absolutely matching our product and advertising and also our culture of the company. When we said neighbors, envy, owners, pride, we meant it. That was the ethos of the company. Our company, or this thing was neighbors, envy, owners, pride. And we realized that with a diverse country like India, east, west, north, south, everybody can equate. Not with that guy, but show this, yeah? Show this screen. Oh, yeah, this guy. He won't equate with this guy, but he can equate with this guy, you know. So east, west, north, south, whole of India recognized this guy, and he was arrogant, he was lovable, and he was aspirational, you know. So the baby bloomers could equate with them. Of course, even now, after we resurrected this guy, even the, what I wouldn't say, the baby bloomers have become old now, and now we are millennials, but even they can, what do you call, equate with this guy. So that's how it all started, and here we are, we had this devil, and then, while all this was going on, you know, the Japanese were ruling, but the Koreans were very fast followers. So they were starting to make televisions just like the Japanese were. The Chinese were mass marketers. So they were building massive factories, you know, all across. And they were the mass marketers. Those were the fast followers. And here India was living in a license raj. Everything was licensed, licensed. They were nationalizing, nationalizing. And this is how India was, and this is how the others were. And suddenly, India went broke. India was on its knees. We were asked to miss a meal. I don't know, you girls, your young kids out here will never realize those days, but we were asked to miss a meal on Thursday night so that India had no food to eat. So that was the time when India was down and out, absolutely. So when we had no reserves, nothing, when we had to miss a meal also, things are extremely bad. The Prime Minister had nothing to do but to open the gates. And wham, here came the multinationals with the big brands and the deep pockets. And we were children, you know, like compared, and here these are the big boys and we had to compete with them, you know. And we were swamped. We were swamped and we got killed, you know. So when you may say that was a decline, it was not really the decline. It was the bad government policies, you know. And to add insult to injury, each state gave sales tax advantage, income tax advantage, excise advantage. Say, what rubbish, you know. You have to set up 20 factories. Everybody had 20 factories in India. One in Delhi, one in Noida, because they were two different states. One in Uttar Pradesh, I mean, one in... Every state, we had a factory. 20 factories for each manufacturer, you know? I mean, it was ridiculous. I mean, how do I compete with somebody who doesn't pay 18% sales tax? So anyway, and of course, these guys with the deep pockets, the multinationals, they swamped everybody and all. Out of the 50 factories that were there alive in 1985, there's only one alive, us. All because of the fact that we said that we will stay on the quality and we will, you know, keep our, what you call, quality absolutely up to date and innovation up to date. So things are really, really bad. But now came Mr. Modi. And suddenly the whole world changed for us. He introduced GST and it became a level playing field. When it became a level playing field, no benefits for anybody, it's all on the level, and suddenly ONIDA got resurrected. ONIDA got resurrected, and here we started making profits. We started making profits, and now for the last 6 quarters, we've been making excellent profits, you know. And this is how it all went. But Modi promoted the brand India, and all these multinationals are going to be coming in with their big brands, and the Chinese are going to come in with their cheap products. And India is going to get squeezed in between. Now, here comes the job of the marketing people. You will have to now take a very good stance on lobbying. Lobbying, not only that, when you market not only just the products. You better market your company also. Modi is marketing the country, and you, all of you who are marketing people, will have to market your company and lobby with the government that here you open up the floodgates, and not only that, you are allowing everybody to come in, and you are putting a 28% GST on us and a 10% custom duty on us with a 40%, and yet we want to compete with all the guys from all the people who are coming into the world. I don't think India will get squeezed. Now, when India gets squeezed, we have to accept it. Whatever happens in life, you have to accept and move on. Now, I say, when this happens, when the big guys come, all the small guys come, the ease of doing business is not very good in India, you know. When all these guys will come to India, they'll get bazooked, you know, how to do business in India. Now that's where you come in. There'll be lots of mergers and acquisitions, there'll be lots of marriages, and there'll be lots of divorces and within the corporate world. And it is your job as a marketing people to recognize opportunities when they come. So anyway, so that's how it is. And there will be great opportunities, and I'm going to show you this next slide. is about a book, which I thought it's on an open mind. So in the open mind, you'll see these, what do you call, here, this will make it big, the master opportunities. Opportunities will come your way, and you'll have to find opportunities which the competitors cannot find or won't find. If you do that, you are going to succeed. So the role of marketing is going to expand exponentially. To all you guys, you have to understand one thing. You have to now merge marketing with R&D. You have to give the consumer something that the R&D was giving, now the marketing has to give. You'll have to even look at strategy. And strategy is doing something else. Doing not just operational excellence. Most of you all are going to be into operational excellence, but operational excellence is not going to get you anywhere. Strategy will get you everywhere. Strategy is to doing something which you haven't done up to now, and maybe not doing something which you're already doing. So you have to be looking, and I can tell you, all of you all have to be fanatics to find opportunities, because you don't find opportunities. And this is a book written by Richard Rothman about opportunities, how to recognize opportunities. I don't know what he saw in me, but I'm also there with all the industrialists of India. So maybe if any of you read this book, you'll find how to recognize opportunities and how to leverage these opportunities. Yeah. Of course, I would like to say that you guys are all very familiar with this thing of the awards that took place, just now recently. And what did you see in that? All the companies that won the award, their market capitalization. So you guys will also have to be finance people. You'll also have to see that while your products are selling, the market capitalization of your company is also going up. So that is also as important to be done, And you'll have to, create opportunity. Like, if this is your company, you have to create baby bells to mix with all the foreigners who are coming. Don't let them take over your company, but create a step-down company and merge with all this and then grow. Sometimes these baby bells in America are worth more than a mother bell. So you will have to create wealth for your company, because I can tell you, if you are over the age of 45, that's the age of retirement nowadays, huh? Nobody will hire you. Age of 45. We are looking for younger and younger people. For us, we have separated the ownership from the management. I may be the owner of the company, but I don't run the company. This is my corporate social responsibility initiative that I'm doing, that I'm talking to you here today. My company is run by young people, and they're doing a fantastic job. Even better than what I can do. Unfortunately, India, like the West, has a very hierarchical culture. It's all done by consensus and the people on top, And it's not an individualistic culture like in the West, where young kids take all the decisions. So the seniors are very troubled to take these tough decisions. You will have to help them, because the seniors would rather be the head of the chicken and not the tail of the tiger. But I tell you, there's more value in the tail of the tiger, So I have only 2 minutes more to speak. So I want to just say that our aim in life is to make Indians proud of the Made in India label. That's our goal. And you as marketing people will play a key role in whatever happens. And you'll have to play a key role in the destiny of your company. Because you have to ask, all of you have to ask yourself, what is the legacy that you'll be leaving behind so that your company not only survives, but also prospers under these very, very tough conditions. I leave you with that thought, and I'll tell you about the last slide which I wanted to put on. Can you please, it is something which you'll, it is very relevant, that every morning in Africa, a deer wakes up. It knows it has to run faster than the fastest lion, or it'll be killed. Next one. Every morning in Africa, a lion wakes up. It knows it must run faster than the slowest deer, or else it will starve to death. Next one. It doesn't matter if you're a lion or a deer. When the sun comes up, you guys better be running. Thank you.